is hard to overstate just how big of a deal the Snapdragon X Elite is. So I'm out here in Taiwan for Computex, and Qualcomm and I have been collaborating on this video for months.
From the initial announcement at the Snapdragon Summit last year, I visited the Qualcomm HQ in San Diego, taken several trips to visit Microsoft to learn about the Windows part of the story, and I might have called in a few favors to get my hands on an actual laptop powered by Snapdragon X Elite way before launch. Buckle up, my friends.
So if you take nothing else away from this video, it is this. These Snapdragon X series processors are a huge disruptor to the Windows space. For many years, we've had two competitors duking it out. And while we've seen improvements, they've been slow. Qualcomm with their Snapdragon X series is here to shake things up. First and foremost, these are good PCs, period. Now, there's a lot of great stuff with the Copilot Plus initiative. There's a lot of cool features, but ultimately none of that matters if you can't deliver a good PC experience. Now you might be wondering, what's so special about a Snapdragon processor? Now you may already be familiar with Snapdragon branding. I mean, odds are the phone you're using right now is either powered by a Snapdragon chip or it uses a Qualcomm modem for 4G or 5G. Well, with Snapdragon X Elite, you've got the same architecture that powers your phone, making the move to Windows. Now this has some baked-in advantages. It is a much more streamlined architecture, unlike x86 or x64, which AMD and Intel have used for literal decades. x86 is incredibly powerful, but it's inefficient. I mean, there's just a lot of baggage there when you consider performance and especially battery life. To get the best performance, apps really do need to be designed with Windows on Snapdragon in mind. Now, this has been a problem for years. On the Windows side, the first Snapdragon devices actually launched all the way back in 2018. I did a video on that. It was basically just the same Snapdragon 835 processor that was from a flagship Android phone of the time. It hardly lit the world on fire, but importantly, the building blocks were there years before Apple ever brought out Apple Silicon. So I have a large number of the devices here in the booth, but the main thing that we're seeing across the board is good battery life and good performance. And I think those are the core tenets that you have to have for these things to be competitive. So you need to have the performance. You need to have the compatibility with your apps, but importantly, you need to have a reason why you would switch. And the battery life, I think, is going to be a very, very big one. That plus the Copilot Plus features when it comes to stuff such as Recall, such as Co-Creator, as well as things like Live Translate, as well as a ton of apps that are gonna be taking advantage of the NPU that is built inside of every single Snapdragon X series chip. I think it's really important. The main task is getting developers to optimize their apps. Now, there is a lot of work to do here, but many popular apps have been updated lately, and according to Microsoft, 90% of minutes used by the average person will be in optimized apps such as Chrome and Spotify. It's an impressive figure, although it will certainly depend on what kind of user you are. Now, when it comes to older apps that haven't been updated yet or may never see an update, there is a clever solution. The Prism emulator. This translates unoptimized apps just like how Rosetta 2 does for the Mac. Now, while there might be a slight performance dip, Microsoft claims that their emulation performance has been improved to be on par with Rosetta. Even inside most unoptimized apps, you'll still see performance generally on par with a 12th gen Core i7. Although again, your mileage will vary. The idea though is essentially as an end user, you don't really need to know or care if your app has been optimized. Everything should pretty much just work. Now we do think that this is true for most of the stuff that you would do on a thin and light laptop, but there will almost certainly be some edge cases that either will run significantly slowly or just cause general problems. Now, that being said, they have spent years working on this emulator. And in my use of the X Elite, the only issue I've seen is with kernel-level anti-cheat software in some games, which just isn't supported yet. Gaming side's a little bit complicated, if I can go on a slight tangent, because for gaming, very few games are optimized specifically for Snapdragon on Windows. Very few. But the thing is, the GPU is a full DX12 GPU. Now, yes, you're gonna have a small CPU sort of penalty by running it through emulation, but gaming is actually quite possible. Now, if I can give you a word of advice if you're considering pre-ordering or buying one of these Snapdragon X series devices, specifically if you're really wanting to lean into the Copilot Plus and the AI, RAM is very important. 16 gigs is the standard. Every single one of these devices has at least 16 gigs. But even going up to something like 32 gigs is actually not a crazy idea, because the more AI workloads that you really lean into, a lot of them are very memory hungry.
Now, considering that I don't have hands-on with final shipping hardware, it would be reckless, bordering on outrageous, to run benchmarks and draw any kind of conclusions for that. But, you know, hypothetically speaking, I mean, if I were, I don't know, daily driving an excellent device for the last couple of weeks and, you know, maybe some benchmarks accidentally fell on it and I blanked out and I came to, there's some scores on my screen. I mean, I bet those scores would be pretty decent, you know? I mean, hypothetically speaking, you know, it's a plausible deniability is what we call it in the biz. Don't get me in trouble, please. So, how does the X Elite actually deliver this kind of performance? Allegedly. Well, part of this is thanks to a bigger, much more aggressive design compared to the 8CX chips that came before. Qualcomm has built the X Elite after acquiring Nuvia and directly integrated these powerful CPU cores into X Elite. Take the Apple M3 and the current MacBook Air, for example, which has 4 performance cores and 4 efficiency cores. Well, X Elite has 12 full performance cores. Now, technically, they're actually split into 3 clusters, one of which is more power optimized, but effectively, it is a lot of raw horsepower. Then there's the quite extensive rework on Windows that Microsoft have done for their Copilot Plus initiative, which means that Windows is heavily optimized for these chips, especially when it comes to multi-threaded tasks. The laptops themselves shouldn't look much different, but the key is how much more refined they are. Unlike most Windows laptops, the fans will be a lot less likely to spin up at all, and you'll get real all-day battery life. Now we've seen some hypothetical numbers that are legitimately wild, and you get that paired with performance. Now each laptop maker will decide to fine-tune their devices differently, so the final experience you'll get will absolutely vary. Now personally, I would love to see full performance when you're unplugged, which if I'm honest, I'm not entirely sure we're going to see just yet, but ultimately that's down to the manufacturers and really down to Windows on how much you want to power manage versus let us, you know, eat ice cream for dinner. Sometimes I know it's not good for me, but it's really tasty. Let me have full performance when I'm unplugged, okay? I get it, I'll plug in later, but I'm gonna go really fast now. Mom? No, I'll admit, this is a little bit more anecdotal, but when I was attending the Snapdragon Summit last year, where they first took the wraps off of X Elite, I sensed a lot of confidence from Qualcomm. It was interesting to see how confident they were about a platform for Windows, which at the time they were, and still kind of are at this very second, a very small player in, you know? I mean, they're detailing a huge new line of processors, they're doing it over 6 months before launch, and the numbers that they've quoted were pretty much blowing everyone away. Since then, we have seen the competition up their game. We've seen both Intel and AMD update, as well as, kind of hilariously, not only Apple to launch their M3 line, but also their M4 line. It's almost like they're scared, or everyone's stuffing giant NPUs in their chips as fast as humanly possible. It's probably the latter, actually. They got that big top synergy. To truly understand the Snapdragon X Elite, back in March, I was able to take a quick trip to Qualcomm's headquarters. Hidden away on their massive campus and behind many, many locked doors was a hardware testing lab that I got to experience. This is just one of many labs they have worldwide, each with a singular focus, pushing technology to its limits. More power, baby! That's not really what they said, but that was kind of the vibe. You know, it was a little bit of the like, hey, we're gonna break stuff, because that's our job in the lab, and I support that. Inside, dozens of Snapdragon X Elite testing platforms were housed, cleverly disguised as ordinary red laptops and oversized tablets. These aren't consumer products, they're reference designs, full of debug ports, and with a bunch of very excited engineers with the sole goal of getting stuff to break. Every crash caught here means one step closer to a product being ready for the world. Now, my access was understandably limited in this very, very top secret lab, behind the banners that they had so carefully erected, not to say that I peeked or anything, because I never do that, but they had rows and rows and rows of testing benches that were almost definitely testing secretive prototypes, just waiting for their day in the sunshine. I really wanted to peek. In the last couple of months of looking at what the Snapdragon team has done here, it's really impressive. And you can see the variety of the OEMs who are actually building devices on day one, because Qualcomm and Snapdragon are trying to be a core fundamental player in the Windows space. And I'll be honest with you, everything that I've seen over the last 6 months, everything I'm seeing with these devices that are about to start shipping, gives me a lot of confidence that they're being very, very serious. It's not one of those things that, look, if we're being really honest, the Snapdragon stuff in the past, specifically on Windows, was less than ideal. You had battery life, you had some 5G connectivity, but it wasn't a very, very strong competitor.
That's not the case now. The Snapdragon X Elite and the X Plus, these are forefront, top of mind when it comes to what everyone is talking about here at Computex, and it's for good reason. They have basically come out of, I don't want to say nowhere, but they've come out of obscurity in the Windows space and become a real competitive threat. And I'll be honest with you, my next PC is on the table right here. Which one it is? Well, you'll have to wait and see. Obviously, I want to spend time with final devices. I spent an enormous amount of time with pre-production stuff and engineering samples and talking with all the OEMs. And like, final thing that I'm waiting for really is to live with them. And living with a device that's final, because I think it's an important part of the thing. And the questions I have are fairly small at this point. I need to see app performance be good across the board, even with unoptimized apps, even though most apps are optimized at this point, or at least a lot of apps are optimized. There's still a lot of stuff that you're going to be leaning on that Prism emulation layer for. And I want to make sure that that performance is good. On top of that, I want to make sure that it's a good, stable experience. That's one thing that I think is always hard to know before you actually spend weeks and months actually daily driving these things. Like, are you running into crashes or slowdowns or weirdness? And while I'm very optimistic, I want to find out. But the bottom line is this. These Copilot Plus PCs are good PCs, period, with a lot of great AI features on top that will be continuing to be built out over the years. But I think you have to think about it from that perspective. AI is great. A lot of these tools and features and functionalities, they are great. But ultimately, none of that matters if you don't have a great, solid PC to actually run them on. And that's really what we're seeing here. The performance, the battery life, and all the additional things that are built on top of that. And if the Snapdragon team can really iterate and sort of continue to develop this sort of platform, make sure that the driver support is there, make sure that Windows continues to really treat it as a first-class citizen, I think it's a really bright future. Now, if you want to pre-order them yourself, you can absolutely do so with the link in the description. They'll be actually shipping very shortly, June 18th. And stay tuned. I am this close to borrowing a device or two, bringing it back home, and spending some real time daily driving these things. But like, I am incredibly excited, and I really want to give a sincere thank you to Qualcomm and the Snapdragon team. Obviously, they've sponsored this video, but this is not a normal sort of hands-on experience kind of thing. I've spent months really trying to understand these chips because it's a huge deal. It's easy to like sort of bypass, like, oh, it's whatever, but like, no, this is a big deal. Like, this is a huge moment for Windows. It's a huge moment for Qualcomm and for Snapdragon, a huge moment for Microsoft. And I think it's really something that I'm excited to be able to play a part in and to understand and make sure, because my expectations here are incredibly high. And while we're not at the finish line just yet, we're almost there. And from what I've seen, this is going to be one of the biggest leaps for Windows ever.